Hello. It's the 1 year anniversary today of my first ayahuasca ceremony. And I thought this would be a great chance to review what has changed as a result of that in my life, in my viewpoints, in my nature. And I'll try to keep this one short and just hit the biggies. There are some biggies. Let me first of all say that major changes, milestones, life has moved ahead again. So anyone who is unhappy, bored, stagnant, feeling just looking for more, for answers, if this is calling to you, I would highly recommend it. It definitely gives you new fuel to reshape, rethink, and move your life ahead. So a year ago, I had never heard of the word entheogen. I was not aware that there was a word to describe plants, substances, and ceremonies that would allow a person to have a spiritual experience. That is, as I would say in terminology I would use now, to look behind the veil, to connect solidly and have an experience of your higher self, of the fact that everything is one, that we are all, I am all, it is all, everything, however you want to put it, wherever, whatever point you're at with your ego, that such substances exist, can be obtained and used, although mostly illegally. However, thank goodness for religious freedoms. They are protecting them and honestly get away from the Western world and our materialistic view. And most older cultures have a very special revered place for entheogens, for plant teachers, for certain chemicals. Mushrooms, venoms, for these kind of purposes. They weren't just talking rhetoric, theory, when these cultures spoke of the Great Spirit and their knowledge of God and describing the material realm. And we might look down on them for their terminology, their lack of science, but they knew where it was at. So my own viewpoint, formerly materialistic, and honestly the most tragic form of materialism, that middle road materialism, where I had been taught that there was indeed a God, a great spirit force that had put things in motion, and there was so much logic and pattern and design in this reality that I certainly would accept that there had to be an intelligence behind it. So I was the sort of materialist that while they believed that there were spirits, you know, angels, demons, good, bad, ghosts, non-material consciousnesses, I myself, humans, we were dirt. We were dirt that, you know, maybe with a boost from the spirit realm, God had become conscious and sentient, yet we were dirt, we died, we were vulnerable, we were separate from God in the spirit realm, ignorant, scared, fragile, frail, insignificant, and yet we still had to contend with and appease this invisible realm that we had no part of. We, you know, that viewpoint wants it both ways. Material and spiritual in the least favorable mishmash that we can conceive of. Of course, the materialists think that we are just dirt. There was a mysterious Big Bang. Energy formed the basic particles, which formed eventually up to larger particles like electrons and neutrons and protons, which intelligently, not the word they would use, spontaneously arrange themselves in stable atomic forms, which found each other and hooked together in wondrously arranged molecular forms, formed plasmas and gases and liquids and solid matters, formed up in crystals, arranged themselves into swirling vortexes of nebulas and galaxies and suns and planets, which spontaneously then produced life, which then spontaneously, billions of years later, produced intelligence. This is a scary world. This is a world where you don't want to leave your laundry laying around too long, or you'll wind up with a transformer that in their competitive system will take over everything. It doesn't add up to me, and you have to very dogmatically be determined that there's only dirt, and so it must have somehow arranged itself this way. The fact that they can somehow insert the word entropy into a universe that is dirt, that is constantly arranging itself in ever more complex and wondrous forms, is the ultimate oxymoron, paradox, contradiction. I wasn't quite that bad, because that never did really make sense to me. I was in that limbo materialist spiritual person, but now I would say I've flipped that all around. What I saw behind the veil, the realization I had when I went in there to explore, and the nature of the questions I actually went in there with, which were answered beautifully the very first ceremony, the base level of the universe, the essential ingredient, is consciousness itself. God's a loaded word. Let's call it the all that is, the source. And this consciousness, this all that it is exploring every conceivable thing that it could possibly be. Every nature of creation, every nature of creature, consciousness, sentience, matter, spirit, energy, vibration that it can possibly be, the very thought of conceiving of it causes it to experience it, which is essentially what reality is all that is experiencing itself in every way it thinks of. So rather than being the base level of kindergarten awareness here, I think we're actually the newest, craziest, most furthest removed from the truth, the pinnacle of ludicrous conceptualization of what all that is could possibly be. We are pure light, love, conscious energy, imagining what it would be like to be a lump of dirt, vulnerable, killable, extinguishable, separate from the universe, isolated as our own species, not sure if there's even anything else out there, in a multitude of us all having this experience at the same time. And rather than being primitive, we are the very latest, greatest, craziest fad in all that is exploring its own consciousness. And I think once we wake up, or die, depending on how you like to phrase that, we are going to be so amazed at this experience that we have had that after a brief circle of running around and story swapping and yahooing, we're going to dive right back in here and try something even crazier. So if you think the world is going to hell, it might be. But that's only from our perspective. From all that is, from the perspective of all that is, it just thought of an even crazier way to express itself. We're cutting edge. That's the viewpoint, the understanding of the nature of this existence I get when I'm under the influence of an entheogen. I hang on to it here. I gotta admit, I don't feel it as much here, but I'm working on that. So that would be takeaway number one, that the universe is at heart, at basis, underlying all that is, super cosmic entity of intelligence, light, love, and power. Not dirt. Number two takeaway, leading directly from that viewpoint change, is the very nature of cause and effect. What's really going on here? This world around us, formed primarily of energy and thought, then the prime mover, the prime cause in it, is thought itself. It functions very much like a reflection, like a mirror back to us, of what we are thinking, expecting, conceiving, the beliefs we have, the expectations we have of this reality, of ourselves in it, and our relationship to it, is reflected back to us by the nature of society, other humans, the planet itself, weather. Our life experience is a reflection of our own understanding of ourselves in the world. Which means that our system of cause and effect, where we go out and move pieces of dirt around and negotiate with other people or force or try to affect things first and then react to them once they're arranged the way we think they need to be for us to be happy or powerful or rich or whatever, is like trying to force the mirror to smile at you so that you will be smiling. To change your reflection in the mirror, you don't have to do anything to the mirror. You have to change yourself. And that basic understanding, that change in the cause and effect relationship, could take the rest of my life to explore, to reevaluate, to sift and turn around, to get right. Hopefully I don't have to get it right, completely right, thoroughly right, before I enjoy the benefits of that understanding. And I would say I am already receiving huge benefits, huge boosts in confidence and understanding, in the knowledge that I have power and control over my life. Now, that viewpoint has completely changed. Rather than exploring, searching, seeking for the truth, sifting through all of the different opinions and lines of thought and theories that are expressed, and wondering which one I should be acting on, which one will get the results I want, which is the truth, the right way, I now believe that all truths are valid. Whatever you choose to believe, whatever you pick as your story, your belief system, your way things are, will be reflected back to you. I can choose the ones I prefer, form the best story that I can manage to honestly believe in, because believing in a lie is going to reflect back to you honestly what you really believe. And you will get back the reflection of a person who's acting out a fantasy. However, if you can honestly believe in anything, form up an understanding, conceptualize it, and act on it, I think you can have whatever you can honestly believe in. It's hard to make quantum jumps in that, but bit by bit, I am changing my beliefs one step at a time, stacking up new beliefs, much the same way I got trained as a child into the cause and effect belief system of society and material world that I had. I'm building a new belief system based on the spiritual insights I've had under ayahuasca, and it works much better. And the main thing is, I'm confident to actually choose beliefs without wondering if they're right or true or not. Because I do realize that every truth is valid. The only real laws here that I think we have to acknowledge is that I am, I exist, and that the nature of reality is energetic, thought-based. Upon those two basic pillars, then, everything after that, essentially, choose and see what you can do with it. So I would say I rolled kind of sneakily into number three revelation there on that one. And probably the number four big revelation takeaway is the nature of my own self, how permanent I really am. Rather than feeling fleeting, temporary, fragile, insignificant, I now have this sense that as a very valid concept, idea, thought of all that is, that it conceived of, that it's exploring, I am here. I'll hazard to use the word stuck here. If I refuse to grow and expand and learn, I will be stuck here at this level of experience and understanding, rather than being easily destroyed and swept away and insignificant. The only way for a thought, an idea of all that is, to end is to play itself out to the very limits of its possibilities in every direction that it can go. And so I can only get out of here if I want to get out of here. And honestly, if I start doing this right, it should be a lot of fun. And maybe I won't want to get out of here so fast. And it's getting better all the time, and I am getting there. Is that number five, maybe? But number four, I am so indestructible. We are here. We are going to play this out. We are going to learn and grow and evolve and develop in every direction possible until finally we wind up right back at the beginning of place. We've grown to the point where all that is will look at us and say, what am I? And the answer will be all of our life experience. And we will have gotten to the point where we will look at all that is and go, what am I? And we will look at everything that is. And in that moment, we'll be all that is, and all that is will be us. And then we'll have another crazy thought, and we'll be the ones that spawn, originate, start off a new thought to explore that will duplicate our own journey to the same point. As far as I can tell, that is the nature of what is going on here. There's no one to save, nothing to prove. The reality itself isn't so real, but the experience of it is very real. And that experience is the point in and of itself. I read a great line in a blog post today, that rather than matter being the foundation of everything, as we've supposed, matter is the foam on the ocean of consciousness, thought, and energy. So I'm going to explore in some further posts what I call dream logic. Because dream logic is the kind of logic that will really get results in cause and effect. That is to say, suppose you're having a dream where you cannot run. You are very sluggish. There's something chasing you and you're terrified and your legs just won't move. In this world, we would go to a doctor and see what's wrong with our legs. See if we can apply for some disability. In the dream world, of course, you will realize that your inability to run in the dream reflects some fear you have of your own inadequacies, the inescapableness of whatever is chasing you. You would go at it much more psychologically, trying to determine what the symbols in your dream meant. This world is working much more like a dream than I have ever considered before. And the problems, the situations, the reflections we're getting back should be analyzed in much the same way that dreams are. So I'm getting some amazing insights as I meditate on these things that I'm going to explore. Some of them are general and comprehensive enough. I think people would benefit from them, and honestly, I'm going to have fun exploring them, so watch or not. The other aspect of that is that the universe helps us with these things. I mean, under meditation now, I realize that every question I've ever had, everything I've asked and prayed about, I've gotten an answer. Without an illustration, he would not speak. The answers have been in these reflections. The universe I perceive is custom tailored to me, and it contains all the reflections, all the answers, all the information that I've ever been looking for. But I've been so blinded and focused and narrow-minded and dismissive that I've never realized that all these quotes and cat pictures and videos were for me. They are sometimes just direct illustrations of how things are working out as a reflection, but often they are actually direct answers from my higher self, from the consciousness of the universe, to what I'm thinking about. And I just need to learn to A, recognize them for what they are, and B, accept them and think about them and integrate them and know that, as I said earlier, all truths are valid. There's not just one answer. I can pick the answer I like the best that leads where I want it to go. The possibilities are endless. I'm in control. I'm eternal. And the very worst thing that can happen to me is I'll die here, pop out of this reality into the reality where I realize and can see what's going on here, that this is just a crazy scenario I'm playing out, and from there decide to come back and play it again, or to go do something else. I imagine there's a lot of people that would get quite upset that I would hold a viewpoint like that. And honestly, it still slips away, even on me once in a while. This story can get pretty convincing and dark due to old choices and patterns of thinking that I haven't analyzed and labels I haven't changed yet. But I think if you're actually watching this, you're open-minded enough to accept the possibilities and are intrigued and, get back to your ethnogen of choice. Talk to you next time.